This is on a personal level. I've had a couple times where I've had prophetic words that were very, very, very specific. Go here, this day, do that, that kind of thing. And there was one that had two parts to it. In the first part, the person spoke that I was going to be in a situation, a work situation. It was going to come to an end rather abruptly. There was evil and witchcraft being spoken behind closed doors, and I was going to be ousted. And I discounted that whole thing because I love this. I had a great relationship with the president and the owner, and it just was a perfect scenario, and I didn't have any reason to believe there was anything going on. And then 17 days later, it all came to a halt, and I was escorted out the door.
Yeah.
And then this guy spoke a second part about me going to Phoenix, and that there was a guy that owned a car dealership there who was going to give me a new car. So the question is, because the first part was right, does that automatically mean the second part is right? And I mean, I know what I personally have done with this, but I would like your input as to how to handle that, how much to put into prayer, brooding over that, or whatever.
Yeah, this is such an important principle, especially when it comes to the prophetic, because there is the mixture between revelation, our own thoughts and our opinions, and our own interpretation of revelation. So you have one piece that's pure, that is exactly what the Lord is saying, and then you have other pieces that may or may not be. And that is pretty common. And you can actually find this in Scripture. If you go to the book of Acts, and I think it's chapter 21, around there, you look up Agabus and Paul, where Agabus and Paul meet. Agabus gets this prophetic word for Paul. He goes up to Paul. He takes Paul's belts off and off of Paul, and he binds his hands and says, in this way, the owner of this belt's hands will be bound by the Jews, and they will hand him over to the Romans. And so you have this clear prophetic word. Hand's going to be bound by the Jews, and the Jews are going to hand him to the Romans. Now, you fast forward, I think it's a chapter and a half, two chapters, and Paul gets to Jerusalem. Paul goes into the temple, and the Jews start a riot. The Jews try to kill him. The Romans come, they save him from being killed, and the Romans bind him. And then the Romans are trying to hand him over to the Jews, but he has to appeal to Caesar so that he doesn't end up getting handed over to the Jews by the Romans. That's not the prophetic word. Prophetic word was the Jews were going to bind him, hand him over to the Romans, but what actually happened is the Romans bound him and saved his life from the Jews and were trying to hand him back to the Jews versus the other way around. So there was some right revelation, but there was some wrong interpretation, wrong application. Now, I think the interpretation was basically correct. Being bound, being handed over, negative, bad things happening. Now, but the application, the Jews are going to bind and hand over to the Romans, wrong. Agabus missed it. And yet, he didn't. He didn't have all the details right, but he had accurate revelation. So sometimes what happens is somebody will get some revelation. And often revelation does not come in a word-for-word format. So you have thoughts, you have pictures, you have ideas, and you've got to figure out how to coalesce them and then communicate them in a way that does justice with the way that it came to you in the first place and conveys the heart of God. That's the hard part of prophecy. It's easy to get the revelation. That's the real easy part. All you got to do is just quiet yourself, pay attention, and ask. And you'll get revelation if you believe. It's the measure of faith. We prophesy according to the measure of our faith. But once you get it, what are you going to do with it? And that's where the level of skill and maturity begins to come in. And Agabus was a mature prophet, but he still got caught up in what was going on and missed the application. That's one of the things that can happen. The other thing that can happen is you can get one piece of revelation, but you want to give more because it feels incomplete or incorrect. And especially if the person that you're ministering to is not responding and you don't feel like it really landed, which that would have fit very well with what was going on. And so there's this giving this prophetic word, probably clear revelation, shares it. It's completely accurate, but the person receiving it doesn't think that it's accurate. They're like, nope, you missed it. And it's not landing on them. They're not receiving it. They're not crying. They're not laughing. They're not smiling. They're just that confused look. And I don't know how many times you've been in that situation, but I've been in that situation a lot. And it is really hard to hold on to your confidence in what God is saying in that moment when the person doesn't seem to be receiving it at all. And you're just wondering, am I missing this? Did I completely lose it? And it doesn't feel like it lands, and you want to give that person something of value. And so there's the temptation to keep on searching for more. Now, couple things. Did he know before he gave you the word that you used to live in Arizona?
No.
So he picked up a word of knowledge. He picked up Arizona, right? He probably picked up that at the time you needed a car. And he put them together in an interpretation that was incorrect. So there was some prompting, there was some revelation there, but the application, the interpretation didn't fit. And that most often with misprophetic words, somebody that's genuine, it's going after the Lord, it's usually the interpretation and the application that it fell down in. There's usually some revelation there, but when you try too hard, it's easy to mess it up. And that's a great learning point for all of us as we're pressing in. When you try too hard, it's really easy to mess it up. So watch that, because that's a principle to learn from.